combination of two or more number of strings. That's why it is said to be a composite spring. And other name for this is a concentric spring, since the coils of both the springs are concentric with each other, and the spring is also known as a concentric spring. Okay, so we'll see the analysis behind this concentric springs in today's class. Right, concentric or composite springs. So the main purpose of using this concentric or composite springs is to obtain greater spring force within the given limited space, right? So to increase the spring constant or spring rate of the spring, or to obtain a greater spring force, you can go for the concentric or composite springs. And second one is to ensure the operation of the mechanism in the case of failure of one of the springs, or to avoid the disturbance in the running of mechanism in case of failure of any one of the springs, right? So the first purpose is to increase the spring force. To increase the spring force in the given space. And second purpose of using this type of springs is to avoid the disturbance in the operation of mechanism in case of failure of one of the springs. So these are the two purposes of using the concentric or composite springs, right? So as I said earlier, one of the helical spring is inserted into the another helical spring, right? So that means if you consider concentric spring of two helical springs, right? So both the springs are having opposite helix. That is the first condition. Both the springs must have opposite helix. Let us take the right. This is a line diagram of opposite spring. So this is inner spring, and similarly you take the outer spring. So look at the outer spring, it is of opposite helix. So now here we can take the dimensions of this spring. This is coil diameter. Let us take second spring, coil diameter of second spring D2, and the wire diameter of second spring is, this is a wire diameter whose wire diameter is small d2. Similarly, the coil diameter of first spring, you can consider capital D1, right? And the wire diameter is small d1. Okay. Similarly, you have a radial clearance. This is a radial clearance. Radial clearance is denoted with a small c. Okay. So this is how the concentric spring or composite spring is denoted, right? So the concentric springs are having two purposes. One is to obtain the greater spring force, and second one is to operate the mechanism or to ensure the operation, to avoid the disturbance in the operation of mechanism in the case of failure of one of the springs, right? So here the first condition is the free length of both the springs are equal. Here this is free length. In this case, the free length of both the springs are equal. Okay, so obviously the deflections are also equal. LF1 is equal to LF2. Similarly, delta 1 is equal to delta 2. Since the free length is same, the deflections are also same. Okay, then let us assume that WE is the load applied on composite spring. Load applied on composite spring. Right? And the corresponding shapes on spring 1 and spring 2 are W1, W2. Right? These two are load shapes on 1 and 2. Okay. Load shapes on 1 and 2. Then D1 and D2 are the wire diameters, capital D1 and capital 2 are the coil diameters, and delta 1 and delta 2 are the deflections of the spring, outer spring and inner spring. So 1 repels outer spring, 2 repels inner spring. Okay. Similarly, M1, N2 are number of active turns. Number of active turns. Okay, number of active turns, right? Assume that both the springs are made of same material, right? So both inner and outer springs both are made of same material. Obviously, the shear stress induced in both the springs are almost approximately same, though the diameters are slightly varied, but the material used for both the springs are same. Hence, tau 1 is equal to tau 2. What is the equation for shear stress? K into 8W D1 divided by pi D cube. So this is shear stress in the outer spring. Similarly, shear stress in the inner spring is equal to K into 8WD equal to K2. K1 equal to K2 implies W1 D1 divided by D1 cube is equal to W2 D2 divided by D2 cube. Okay. So this is the first equation. Let us assume this as equation number 1. Okay. Then the next condition. So this equation is based on this shear stress. So shear stress is equal since both are made of same material. Okay. Then the next condition is this one. Deflections are equal. Deflections are equal. Let us take delta 1 is equal to delta 2. Delta 1 is equal to delta 2. Since the free length of both the springs are equal, when you apply the load W on this spring axially, both the springs gets compressed equally. Obviously, the compression in the outer spring is equal to compression in the inner spring. What is the formula for this? 8W dQ n delta equation. 8 into W1 into D1 cube N1 divided by G to the power of 4. That is equal to 8 into W2 D2 cube N2 divided by G D to the power of 4. Okay. Now here, both are made of same material. Hence, modulus of rigidity is same. Decay gets cancelled. Right? Then, W1 D1 cube N1 divided by D1 to the power of 4. Similarly, W2 D2 cube N2 divided by. Okay. So, as I said that the two lengths are equal. So, the solid lengths are also almost equal. Okay. So, since under complete loading condition, deformed condition, the solid lengths are equal. So that is equal to LS1 is equal to LS2. Implies N1 D1 is equal to N2 D2. That is solid length there. Okay, N1 is equal to N2 D2. Now you can substitute in this equation. Let us say this is 2 implies. You substitute this N1 by N1 D1 is equal to, so you can write W1 D1 cube N1 D1 divided by D1 to the power of 5, because here in the denominator I have taken 1 D1, obviously denominator one extra D1 you need to consider here, so D1 to the power of 4 becomes D1 to the power of 5. It is equal to W2 D2 cube N2 D2. Similarly, in the denominator, you will get the D2 to the power of 5. Okay. Then, you can cancel this. Plus, you will get W1 D1 cube divided by D1 to the power of 5. Is equal to W2 D2 cube divided by D2 to the power of 5. So this is, let us take equation number 3. Right? So now divide this equation number 3 with this equation number 1. Right? W1 D1 divided by D1 to the power of 3. W1 divided D1 cube divided by D1 to the power of 5. So now here, divide three with one implies, right, three with one demonstration. Now D1 square, capital D1 square divided by small D1 square is equal to, right, capital D2 square divided by D2 square. So W1 gets cancelled, D1 cube cancelled with 1 D1 here, so that you will get D1 square, and D1 cube in the denominator cancelled with power 3 with this D1 to the power of 5, so that you get this. So implies you can write capital D1 by small D1 is equal to capital D2 divided by small d. Okay, so what is capital D by small d? This is equal to spring index. Okay, so answer is as equation number 4. The springs are designed in such a way that the spring index of both the springs should be same. So from this you can conclude that both the springs, spring 1 and 2, should have same C value. What is C here? C is spring index. Okay. So, the concentric springs should consist of helical springs of same spring index. Okay. Then, you compare the equations 1 and 4. Equations 1 and 4. What is the first equation? W1 even this one. So, by comparing this from 1 and 4 implies, so D1 divided by D1 you can replace with W1 divided by D1 square is equal to W2 divided by D2 square. Okay, so let us take this is equation number 5. The ratio of load shader is inversely proportional to the square of the diameters. That's what we can conclude from this. Right? So, for this, from this d1 by 2, factor d1 by 2, you subtract the small d1 by 2. So, this is with respect to the outer sphere. Right? From this, you need to subtract the inner spring. So, the inner spring is having certain coil diameter. What is the coil diameter of inner spring? That D2. So, you take the radius value minus D2 by 2. Right? Plus, you need to consider this value plus D2 by 2. Okay. So, that means you need this value. This is small c. Okay, the distance from this point to this point, that means overall radius of the outer coil minus the wire diameter of outer spring, and from this you need to subtract this value. This value, how do you get this? D2 by 2 plus small d2 by 2. So this is radial clearance. Usually, small c is equal to average of y diameters. Okay, now you can equate this, right? Let us take this is 6 and this is 7. 6 equal to 7 implies d1 minus d2 by 2 minus d2 plus d2 by 2 is equal to small d1 minus that is equal to small d1 minus d2 by 2. Okay, so if the simplify is finally we get capital d1 minus d2 divided by 2 is equal to d1. You further simplify this, finally you get D1 minus, so the difference of coil radii is equal to the wire diameter. Okay, so but what is capital D1? D1 is equal to capital C into D1. Similarly, D2 is equal to capital C into D. This is small c, right? So radial clearance is small c. Capital C is spring index. Now if you substitute here, then finally you can write the equation D1 divided by D2 is equal to capital C divided by C minus 2. So any concentric spring should satisfy this equation. Let us take this is equation number 2. The ratio of y diameters D1 by D2 is equal to C by C minus 2. Okay, so these things you need to remember here. So we are going to use all these relations in your problems, right? So there is enough concentric springs. So first, both the springs should be of same length, free length, and both the springs are of opposite helix. Since both are having same free length, the reflections are same, and both the springs are made of same material. The shear stress induced is same. From this, you can derive this equation. Okay? Then by considering deflection equation, delta 1 is equal to delta 2, you can derive this equation. Now, by dividing 3 with 1, you will get this equation. Okay? Then radial clearance, later on, the ratio of diameters of wires. Okay? If you know D1 and D2, you can find out W and W. Right? If you know W1 and D1, and you can find out capital D1 and capital D2. Once you have all these values, you can find out deflections, you can find out shear stress values in the springs. Okay.